Hello and welcome to Preparation Avengers, a weekly podcast with up-to-date impressions on every film in the MCU leading up to Infinity War on April 27th. Got the date right that time, guys. I'm your moderator, Thomas Rogers, and joining me this week is Danny Bucky Barnes Kilpatrick.
Good evening, boys.
Paul Falcon Burns.
Yeah.
And Alex Black Widow Hernandez.
I do share. I'm nice like that.
That was one thing I noticed when I went to, I used to go to WizardCon every year.
Oh my God, there's a mosquito.
There's a giant
fly
mosquito.
In my fucking
mouth,
man.
Actually, it's a mayfly. It's here early.
Oh. Well, needs to fucking leave.
Stop you know, they only live for like
We're recording
eight
this
hours.
In March. They're now called March
How
flies.
Is it that fucking huge if they only live for 8 hours?
It went in your mouth?
It keeps trying to fly in my fucking mouth, man.
He's got one of those mouths that bugs just want to fly into.
Yeah.
So we're here to talk about Captain America.
Hold on, but I was going to say, speaking of Black Widow, there's a lot of, we used to play games like count how many fat widows there are.
What?
It was, okay, you know the Black Widow suit, like the latex vinyl looking one?
Yep. Yeah.
There were women who were, I don't know, like, let's say not sub 400 pounds. I don't want to say over, wearing like those Black Widow suits and like in droves.
Good for them. I like that Black Widow would inspire
the confidence.
Yeah. Exactly. That's awesome. Did we have a different experience than you did?
Peb, I was there, right? It was not awesome. Maybe hypothetically it sounds awesome. And you know what? Have fun. Who am I to
say? Like, where is this going?
But I mean, like, MODOK's a character. You could be MODOK. Isn't MODOK cool?
You don't have to be the same size as somebody to dress up as them.
I know. Yeah, I'm just being a dick.
Oh.
That's, you know, thought that was apparent.
Well, if you're new to the show, everybody meet DKP.
Yes.
Dude, if this is your first
mosquito
episode.
Mosquito hawk, man. All right. I'm gonna try to ignore that.
All right. We're here to talk about Captain America, the Winter Soldier. Let's get some facts out of the way. The film was released on April 4th, 2014. So this was about 6-7 months after Thor the Dark World. It had a budget of $177 million compared to Cap 1's $140 million and Dark World's $170 million. So it got a $7 million bump in budget compared to Thor, which is kind of weird to me considering like the amount of like special effects and stuff that you would need to do. But I don't... Actually, no, it does kind
of
make sense.
Were a lot of special effects.
Because special effects, you just have to throw some people in front of a green screen compared to like the amount of actual locations you had to film at in Winter Soldier.
It's true.
And like extras and stuff. Yeah, makes sense now. Now that I'm thinking about it. It had a box office return of $644.6 million compared to Cap's $370 million, so nearly doubled it.
Nice.
And Dark World's $644 million. So it basically made $0.6 million more. It was directed by Joe and Anthony Russo. Or Russo, R-U-S-S-O. That's Russo, right?
Imagine like Russo.
I think they're Russo.
The other film that they've directed is Captain America Civil War. They also directed a metric ton of episodes of Community and Happy Endings. That's another sitcom.
Happy Endings, what's that?
It's a sitcom.
And
it's pretty good.
They're going to be doing Infinity War.
That is correct. That's how much faith and trust these guys got from Kevin Feige. This movie was written by, and this is where shit gets really funny, kind of ironic, was written by Christopher Marcus and Stephen McFeely. They wrote all three Cap movies. They wrote both Infinity War movies, so the one that's coming and then the one that's coming next year. They wrote the Chronicles of Narnia films. They wrote Michael Bay's Pain and Gain. They did the Agent Carter TV series, and they did Thor the Dark World.
Wow.
Wait, so you're saying they also did the first Cap movie?
Yeah, they did all three. They wrote all three.
Oh, wow. This should be interesting.
Oh, I was all with them right till Thor Dark World.
Dude, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's so funny because last episode, I was talking so much shit about what's wrong with Thor the Dark World is the writers.
And then
like, the writing
of
Thor. And here we are, like, arguably my favorite Marvel movie written by the same duo.
You're still correct. They just happened to correct themselves,
yeah, it's just,
I guess.
It's very ironic that they could, you know... That they could write. I guess their heart is in Captain America. Well, let's just put it that way.
There you go.
They didn't write any other Thor movies.
Dude, McFeely, what a fucked up ass name. McFeely. Especially like in today's age in Hollywood. You know what I mean?
What else is, I guess it's interesting. It was interesting to me. They write everything together. Like every one of these things they wrote together, and they've only written stuff together.
I think that's cool.
That's, yeah, they're a dynamic duo.
I mean, they're no Coen brothers, but they're pretty good.
It's true.
They're pretty good.
But it is interesting that there are brother
except when it comes
to
referencing
teams.
Their past movie.
Sure.
For sure. Sorry, what were you saying, Pat?
I was just saying it's interesting that that a brother and brother and sister teams can be so successful our in entertainment system has promoted that. Yeah. But it makes sense because like you can trust them, you can have them back you up.
Is it a brother and sister team?
Well, Coen brothers on and off brother and sister team.
Are you talking about Wachowski?
Or Wachowski?
Yeah, yeah, I was about
the Wachowskis.
Like, they've always just been the Coen brothers.
Brothers
Wachowski
and the siblings
now
the
Wachowski sisters.
That's the one. I'm sorry, I confused the two.
Man, them Coens. I like their movies. Let's get to the cast. Chris Evans stars as Steve Rogers. Samuel L. Jackson.
Our boy Billy Crystal was in this again?
Billy Crystal was in this, yes. Scarlett Johansson as Natasha Romanoff. Robert Redford plays Alexander Pierce. Sebastian Stan plays Bucky Barnes and Winter Soldier. Sorry, spoiler alert. We're going to spoil this movie, of course. Anthony Mackie plays Sam Wilson / Falcon. Kobe Smulders returns as Maria Hill. Frank Grillo.
So hot.
Yeah, Maria Hill's hot. Frank Grillo plays Brock Rumlow. And yeah, we'll talk about him later. Maximiliano Hernandez plays Jasper Sitwell. That's the bald agent who.
It's the one on the ship at the beginning.
Yes. Emily Van Camp plays Kate / Agent 13. Haley Atwell plays Peggy Carter. Toby Jones returns as Dr. Arnim Zola. Gary Shandling plays Senator Stern.
I loved Gary Shandling in this movie.
Yeah,
I loved hating Gary Shandling in this movie.
Excuse you. You loved Billy Crystal in this film.
George St. Pierre plays George Batroc. Now, it's George. So if there's George that has an S on the end of it, is that...
Wait, let me see.
If your name is George, but there's an S at the end of your name, is that Georges?
I think it's just George.
Jorge?
Jorge?
Nah, I don't. It doesn't look like Jorge. I don't know, man.
George with an S at the
Mr.
end.
Mr. St. Pierre.
That's the character's first name and the actor's first name. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Oh, by the way, he is a Canadian UFC champion.
Oh.
That actor.
So wait, which was he? Was he Crossfire?
No, he was the guy that like put up a good fight against Cap on the ship
on the boat. Yeah,
yeah. He plays a character, George. But we'll talk about his character later.
Like George St. Pierre.
Yep. So yeah, DKP, what is the plot for Captain America: The Winter Soldier?
You know, I'm happy that you asked. You know, I've been kind of depressed lately. I was driving over here and I realized that. After watching this fine film, I was driving over here and I realized that we live in a world where there people call shit emojis, and there was a movie made out of it. And then kind of maybe not want to do this anymore, but I'm happy we're doing Guardians next week, and I want to talk about this film that we watched today. Right, this film is a coming of age piece, like every Captain America film. He's a man out of time, like they remarked, and sometimes he's a man who's out of time. Did you get that joke in it? Anyways, this is a movie about Captain America who is just fucking about doing S.H.I.E.L.D. shit. Really cool opening scene. He goes and takes out a tanker. It's very Metal Gear Solid-esque to some degree. Then, after that, Nick Fury gets attacked. And it turns out that we done got some Hydras in our S.H.I.E.L.D. Oh, shit. And the plan of Hydra is to build these helicarriers again, because that's about what S.H.I.E.L.D.'s capacity to do anything is, helicarriers. And their plan of world domination is just to shoot everybody. Because that's going to work. So, but guess whose job it is to stop him?
Is it Captain America?
No, it's Natasha Romanoff.
Oh.
But Captain America tags along as well. They meet a man named Falcon, who's a kind of a poor man's Iron Man, kind of, but a cool enough character on his own, I guess. Billy Crystal, you also find out, is a Hydra agent, and Captain Rogers is on the run to stop S.H.I.E.L.D. from just shooting everyone all at once with three helicarriers, because that'll take over the world. So, in his quest for the truth of who shot Colonel Mustard,
justice in the American way.
Yes. He finds out that there's this man named who they call the Winter Soldier, who no one's ever really talked about. But he's been around for like 50 years, but they're like, oh yeah, well, he's kind of important now, I guess. when it turns out, he looks very familiar. And he wears a shitload of eyeliner, too, which is pretty cool. So they have a run-in. Like I said, Colonel Mustard gets killed.
Who's Colonel Mustard?
Nick Fury.
Okay.
Oh, my bad. So, yeah, then they're off on the run. They steal a car. They go to the mall. It's kind of a fun time. They find, like, an underground bunker with a bunch of videotape.
As you do in a coming-of-age story.
Yes. They shared a nice passionate kiss on the escalator.
And there were, there were two extras behind them that were very awkward. Did you guys notice the extras that were on the escalator?
Didn't, no.
Very awkward. Sorry, I'll let you continue.
No, I mean, this is just meandering shit anyways. So, I don't know, man. Fucking, eventually they're like, all right, they find out that Nick Fury isn't dead after finding out that Hydra's secret plan just to shoot everybody.
You mean Colonel Mustard?
Yeah, Colonel Mustard is still alive. Matter of fact, turns out it takes more than a candlestick to kill that motherfucker. So,
that landed with me very well.
They got like three data chips. They're like, oh, instead of just destroying the ships, which we're going to fucking do anyways, right after we gain control of them. I mean, that's neither here nor there. That's not the plan, though. The plan is to, recalibrate them so they don't shoot everybody, but then just shoot themselves and cause more chaos and destruction. And then they end up kind of doing that. And you find out, oh, god damn it, Winter Soldier's Bucky Barnes.
His bestest bud.
Man, because for some reason, like, yeah, this random dickhead from the American military, that's who we'll use to train. But hold on, we gotta freeze him too, because he's not ready yet. So then, as it turns out, no! And then Bucky has this weird, he was also played, by the way, this is a fun fact. Who's the guy that plays him?
Sebastian Stan.
He's also the Saint, you know what else he's in?
What?
He's the lead frontman for My Chemical Romance, which I thought was pretty fucking cool.
Yeah.
shout out to that guy, right?
Who's My Chemical Romance?
It's a band.
An emo goth band.
Okay, continue.
That landed with somebody out there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Anyways,
didn't they do Black Parade?
Let's see. Huh?
They did Black Parade, right?
I don't know. I know what they look like.
Yeah, yeah.
He has this weird angsty moment where he's like, shut up! Don't talk to me! That's not my name! And then Cap has this obsession with killing himself, which is weird. He tries his hardest to do it a second time, and it doesn't work out.
The end of a Captain America movie, so he has to throw himself in water.
Yeah, but nobody can die in these movies. You just keep getting faked out.
Wait till Infinity War.
Hey, man, we're supposed to not talk about the future, right? So, and then, that's about it. Shields no more, because I don't know. And that's about where the movie ends.
Perfect.
Yep.
Nailed it 100%.
That's what that movie was about.
I think it hit all the beats.
So, Peb and DKP, you guys were on the lower end of the spectrum of your previous impressions of Winter Soldier. I'm very curious to see if those impressions improved. So
we
normally,
do not
actually,
have the notepad tonight.
Yeah,
it is just at my domicile.
Just to interrupt the show real quick.
No problem.
We Peb documents all of the stuff.
I'll write it in my book
here. We
have
these cool sheets. And those sheets are currently at DKP's house because we recorded Thor there. So
We won't be able to know what we predicted.
Won't, we won't remember what... I mean, I remember what I predicted.
I kind of remember. I think I was a 6.
I was a 5.5.
Those sound accurate.
We'll speculate on it when we get there.
So did you guys... Did this movie improve over your suspected scores?
Do you mind if I start?
Yeah, go.
Please.
Had such a great time with this movie.
Yay!
This movie was a whole... Thank you. This movie was a whole lot of fun. There was brilliant action from the beginning. The intrigue made more sense to me this time. Even though I knew it was coming, the moments where I was supposed to feel awesome, I felt so awesome. So, for example, the time where the gentleman, I just have to call this out, best scene in the movie, gentleman comes and he says, you're going to launch those helicarriers. And the kid says, I'm not launching those helicarriers, captain's orders. And man, I'm telling you,
so good.
I get all kinds of chills. It was awesome. So I had just a phenomenal time. And one of the things I noticed this time that I didn't last time is how physical Captain America is. The way that the sound and the lighting and the effects were done put you into the body of Captain America every time it happens. So, for example, when the plane shoots, or when the missile gets shot at Zoloft's bunker.
Zoloft?
Or whatever his name
Arnim
is.
Zola?
Zola's bunker. And they jump into the pit, and then the explosion happens. The whole screen goes dark. Mm-hmm. Whenever he's kicking people, the screen jars just a little bit, and it let
makes
me tell you,
it makes you realize, like, oh yeah, no wonder they got these guys to direct Civil exactly. War, Infinity War Part 1 and 2.
It put me in the action every time, and I loved that. The first time I saw it, I was frustrated because there was so much going on in this movie, I felt like I didn't follow it all. But now, having watched all of these previous movies coming up to it, and having seen this movie before, I got all the story. I knew why everybody was doing what they were doing. And as a result, I was able to just enjoy the masterful movie making that went into this movie.
Yay. So. DKP?
Yeah, there's a lot that I did like. Like, so you got the scene with Peggy Wilson?
Peggy Carter?
Peggy Wilson's from Mad Men, my bad. Yeah, Peggy Carter.
Sam Wilson?
Which, like, that scene was probably, like, the best scene in the movie to me. Because, you know. That was
the same where he goes to visit her in the hospital?
Yeah, because I was thinking, like, man, it would have been really neat for it to show him, like, the first time they met, you know, like, her surprise and shock of seeing him. But then it was like, oh, yeah, she's got dementia. You do get to see that. Wow, well, that ticks that box off. That was masterful, I guess. So the first half of the movie, I was really enjoying it. But right about after the bunker, I fucking, like, just shut my brain off, because it was... here's the thing the problem I have with the fight scenes in it. The first couple are really fucking awesome, especially the tanker, or the ship that they're on.
It was brilliant.
But then it hits a point where literally 90% of the shots are of men firing, like, bottomless machine gun clips.
Yeah, it's
at everything and anything.
I mentioned it when we were talking about it in the Thor, but this is like a spy espionage, like, Mission Impossible James Bond style movie, where it's these, like, endless hordes of enemies with endless amounts of ammo. They're always repelling down things. They just love to repel down things.
They love it.
They love that shit. They're repelling down cars.
I thought it was the only one that realized that bunker scene.
Well,
what do you mean realized the bunker scene?
Like you guys completely said that it was, like, very Mission Impossible-ish, and then when it hits them going to the bunker and Armin Zola, the whole vibe of that movie changes.
Yeah, and it didn't change in a way that I enjoyed it more. I can't, because, like I said, the action scenes just became too long and too much of the same thing. It's like they said, like, okay, instead of having, like, a kind of a quick, concise battle, like, for example, the scene where Cap fights the guy on the boat the first time. I realize there's more to that whole boat scene.
Yeah.
But when he fights that one, the MMA fighter, it's like, that was a really
badass
scene.
Where he does that,
like,
crazy backflip kick. I was watching it with Elizabeth, and I was like, that doesn't seem like a very effective way to fight somebody. And she was like, well, it's kind of a surprise. You don't know that he's actually kicking. You think he's dodging or something like that. But, yeah, that was a cool kick.
Yeah, another backflip that I didn't like was when a Falcon is shooting two, like, Uzis at Winter Soldier, and he just does a backflip and somehow dodges, like, 60 bullets at once. That's, you know, for, you know, that was a back kick that I saw that went, hey, wait a minute. Why, that doesn't seem right. He probably would have gotten shot. One thing I did appreciate was that somebody actually got shot in this movie.
A lot of people died in this
movie. I mean, one of our characters actually got shot.
Cap got the shit beat out of him this movie.
He did.
Big time.
For a movie, okay, look, let's just take the ratio for how many bullets were fired in this fucking movie to how many of our main characters got shot. I was at least happy one person got shot.
So Nick Fury got shot.
Yep. There was that. Natasha got shot.
Natasha got shot.
Yeah.
Captain America got shot repeatedly.
Yeah. Falcon was the only one that came away unscathed, even though... There's a scene, it's the highway scene, whenever Winter Soldier lands on top of the car and then fucking throws Sitwell out of the window into oncoming traffic, and he hits that. Oh, man, that's so badass. But then when the car starts flipping and they bust through and they're landing on the door and the door is skidding, and you see Falcon or Sam Wilson, like, roll on the ground, and it's like he has no road rash on him whatsoever.
Yeah, like, that was a little unbelievable.
There's a lot of, like,
but at the same time,
you have to suspend your disbelief.
I really enjoyed that scene because one of the things that it talked about was how squad mechanics works in relationship to a crazy superpowered superhero types. And so I really like the fact that a well-trained squad was able to give Captain America and Natasha Romanoff a real run for their money. Because the truth is that that's the group you don't want to be fighting. You don't want six well-trained guys who all know each other.
These are elite soldiers that Cap worked side by side with.
Exactly.
You know, leading up to the betrayal.
And so, like, when they would move around, and then, like, that scene when Natasha was coming up under the bridge and she sees his shadow, there's nothing said about it, but it really put me, again, in that moment. And I was like, oh, shit, what's she gonna do? And then the scene pans, and we don't know, and she's not where you expect. It really put me in that moment and made these characters who are doing wholly unbelievable things very believable to me.
One of the things I want to talk about, actually, Idify, did your opinion of this movie change at all based on, I mean, you were at a 10. Did you walk away still at a 10? Where are you at?
Like, I saw the movie Intoxicated, so my initial opinion is completely different than it was at the time. It is still a perfect movie. It is, honestly, it is really good. It is very intense. It's very thriller-ish. Then because of the intoxication, it got very comic booky, like almost to the point where it was kind of ridiculous, but it was very well done.
I don't think you were intoxicated. I think that's how it went. I noticed that, like, too.
No, but like the Armanzola scene, like it changes the vibe completely. You're watching this movie and you're thinking of it as, oh, it's a great, like, espionage spy movie. He's fighting a bunch of people that, you know, that are just average people, not superheroes. And then you get to a guy that's in a computer and the whole bunker's his brain. I'm like, okay, whoa. Now we're comic book again. Now this is a Marvel film. But then after that, it gets back into the suspense, you know, with the bridge scene and then the whole end. It's fantastic.
I don't know. I couldn't have been less on the edge of my seat during those action scenes. Like I said, they went on for a long time.
They're so good, though. They are some of the best action scenes.
No, it's like they went, okay, we have to fill a 15-minute segment, but we don't want to choreograph all of that, so a lot of it is just going to be dudes in a line shooting. And that's like, there was a lot so of fucking much it. Of it. Yeah, but like, just have it shorter and have less just shots of guys shooting endlessly.
We'll talk about the action more, because I think
bore me to death.
I think it's one of the highlights. But something I want to get to that we've all kind of touched on, but one of the things that I love so much about this movie, the same goes for Civil War as well, so I'll talk about it when we get to that episode. But what's great is when you watch Captain America, the First Avenger, it's like, okay, this is a cool movie that takes place in World War II, and then they're going to bring Cap to modern day. And it's like, how do you make a sequel to a movie that took place in the 1940s and make it relevant and make it work and make it still have a lot of the same through lines that existed within the First Avenger? And, like, again, like I said, it goes with for Civil War as well, but there is a clear, like, this is clearly a perfect sequel to it, because the villains are still Hydra. Peggy Carter is still a part of the story, of part of everything that's gone on. Arnim Zola is still in this, like, he is still involved, and his character, like, what happens with him, the whole, I know, like, it lost a couple of you guys about this scene, but the idea of, like, where we left him off in the First Avenger, he was kind of a he was a prisoner,
not
of,
eating steak,
yes,
yep.
He was a prisoner of what would become S.H.I.E.L.D. To the point to where they start using him and he joins S.H.I.E.L.D., but he still has, like, the basis for who he is as a character and what he was trying to accomplish, and his belief still existed, to where he found a way to kind of infiltrate himself into S.H.I.E.L.D. and set the stage for all the events that happened in Winter Soldier and in Civil War. And it's all still one long story. It's all still one character. Like, you can watch the Captain America trilogy outside of everything else, and it works as its own trilogy. And I think
this is my problem.
Really cool.
This is my problem with this movie. This movie does not take into account the first movie. You can literally watch this movie on its own without having to see the first Avenger, and you would be none the wiser. And that is my problem with this movie. Because, like you just said, that whole Armanzola scene, how did he fucking create Bucky? It makes absolutely no sense. He was a prisoner around the same time. No, but yeah, but that's the problem. He was a prisoner at the same time Bucky died. So what? Like, there's just continuity is not work. It's like I said, this movie, you don't need the first movie to understand this one.
So
that's the problem.
He rescued Bucky from a laboratory where he was being experimented on with injections. And then they fight together for some unknown amount of montage time. But
this is all events that happen in First Avenger.
In First Avenger. And then after all of that fighting, they blow up tanks, giant tanks. They do all the other stuff. He falls off the cliff. Right there where Zoloff is...
Right, where they're trying to go capture him.
Right.
So it where makes they, absolutely they do, no capture, sense.
Yeah, so no, it makes perfect sense, because where Zola is being captured is where Bucky falls. So Zola knows where Bucky fell. So it would make sense for Bucky... Like, Zola doesn't stay forever a prisoner. He gives them the information. He trades... the rest of his life for information.
And then he works for S.H.I.E.L.D.
And then later on, he joins S.H.I.E.L.D. It's not like one long thing where he like stays with him the entire time. So it's after he's already started like spreading the seed.
Bucky isn't a super soldier. I'm speculating. He was just a regular human. He was just a regular human. And for him to... Okay, how long did he fucking find Bucky? Bucky was dying for what? I mean, you're going to die in a matter of a couple of days. They didn't release Zola after they caught him.
You probably would if there's a chance that the experiments that they were doing on you prior to didn't give you some sort of like help or support. You know, like they were doing experiments on him in Captain America the First Avenger.
Also, you're not dead until you're warm and dead.
You
can
say it's a stretch.
Remember, he's not a prisoner.
It's a complete stretch.
It's a stretch, but that's the explanation that factually the movie gave.
But do you remember First Avenger, when Cap goes to save him, there are all these cells that have all these soldiers in them. And Cap's like, hey, there's this guy I'm looking for. And when Steve finds Bucky, he's like chained to a table, and they have been doing experiments on him. Like, it's not one of those things that's speculation. It's very clear that they have been doing something. Now, what those things are, you can speculate that what they're doing is something that will allow him to survive a fall like that.
I wish he'd have died, though, you know?
No, I don't.
That made this movie a lot better.
I saw him in the post-credit scene for Black Panther. And I'm very glad he's still alive.
Oh, God.
I love the Winter Soldier. I think that could have used a lot of better.
I think the Winter Soldier is an incredibly fucking boring character. Tommy, you described him as the Terminator.
Yes.
He is not the Arnold Schwarzenegger fun Terminator.
He is a weapon used. Yeah,
Terminator 2 police officer.
He's like T1. I mean, he's like T-1000 Terminator.
They had about the same amount of lines. Have you seen this boy? That's about it. That's about as interesting. That's not good.
But I get what you're saying. I think that he is badass. Do I think
Cap's
that he is
badass.
The most... Yeah, but like, again, the highway scene where he falls and he's like scraping his hand across the thing and he punches... I don't know, man. There are a lot of great action scenes, but basically he is designed to be a weapon. Like, he is not the villain of this movie. He is the weapon that they use in this movie.
So
he's an assassin.
Yeah, but that's like... His character in itself, with the exception of like, oh, but he's Bucky Barnes, is no more interesting than the fucking Dark Elf douche from Thor 2. That guy has more lines.
I could not disagree more.
If the Dark Elf person had as much backstory as what we got in all three of the movies, like, we know who Bucky Barnes is. We know his backstory. Like,
we know his relationship. He's the douchebag that was trying to get Steve laid in one movie ago.
Yeah, we know a lot about this person.
Yeah.
No, I get that, but what I mean is...
And then we got even more of that. Exactly.
Yeah, we even get a scene after Steve's parents die that like
Bucky
flashes
Barnes,
back.
Like old Bucky Barnes, I'm okay with. It's modern Bucky Barnes / Winter Soldier, who I
it's
think
just the idea
is
that
the
he's turned
boring...
into...
No, it's just like the Winter Soldier in its entirety, in itself, his self... is fucking boring.
I think, yes, he is boring the way that you would, like, call an RPG boring. It is very, yes, it doesn't have any character to it. It's just a weapon, but that's what he is. He's just a weapon.
He becomes more interesting as he fights against his nature. And yeah. This movie is just the beginning of that. And I'll give you that in this movie, he didn't have much to do other than...
He had like, what, two lines?
Yeah.
Maybe?
Well, two or three. But he didn't have much to do except start to doubt his own identity. That's really his only purpose in this movie.
He walks away and at the end like fucking Hulk.
He does. You could almost play that piano across.
Looks very similar to the literally way, thought about that fucking music while he's walking
he
away.
He looks similar to how Cap looks whenever Cap goes to the Smithsonian. But we'll talk about that scene later.
No, I'm talking about when he walks away on the shore after he drags Captain America like out of the water. And then like he just sadly walks away.
And he walks away, yeah.
Pretty cool.
Boo.
Yeah, I really love the aspects of this being, the second movie within a trilogy, and I think that's one of the strongest parts about it. I also really love the way that they play up that he's an old man. Yeah. Like, that he's, you know, it's something that they deal with a lot more heavily in the first half than they do in the second half, but... When Natasha rolls up in that Corvette and she's like, hey guys, I'm looking for a fossil.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. And then he's got that that notebook full of stuff once he gets the recommendation. I have that list and we'll go over that during the Secrets of the Marvel Universe.
Oh, okay. Yeah, like there's that's why I think I really enjoyed the first half. Because, like I said, just tonally, it was different.
And I love the relationship between him and Falcon. I thought that was very... You can really easily mess up introducing new characters into an established system. Yeah. And this felt organic and natural. I could understand why these two men liked each other and spent time with each other and could work together so well.
It's cool. It's one of those things that, like... we suck at doing, but when you meet someone that you like idolize or someone that you know is a celebrity or something like that, you act like, at least I do, act like a bumbling idiot, and I'm like, oh, I really loved you in Lost or whatever it
exactly.
is.
Exactly.
But for him to just like not even mention it, you know, he's like, you know, there is a part where he's like, I'm Steve Rogers, and he's like, yeah, I kind of figured that out. Like, it wasn't one of those things where he's like, holy shit, you're Captain America.
He did that a little bit. I felt, at least. Maybe I was just reading into it a little bit much. But like at the very end when they're at the grave, at Nick Fury's grave, and he's like, he seemed like a real giddy, like, yeah, let's do it. And he's like, you gonna come with me? He goes, when do we start? And then he'd probably be like, well, I mean, not right now. Like, we have to...
Well, he has that line earlier as well whenever he's talking to Sam Jack. Like,
would I go with Captain America?
He says, I do the same thing.
You could tell he's being a fan a little bit. But yeah. For the most part, he plays it pretty fucking cool, you know? Yeah. Which, by the way, remember I said there were things that didn't work the first time that worked this time?
Yeah.
I didn't like Falcon the first time I watched it.
See, but I remember you and I talking about it because I said I didn't like Falcon, and you're like, oh, man, I've always liked Falcon.
No, it was not me. I used to call him the poor man's Iron Man.
You
because
did,
that's
you
kind of that's kind of kind of what did, it is. Yeah. He flies around, has regular-ass guns, if he has them on him, and no armor whatsoever.
It's weird. I could have swore you said that you liked
Falcon.
It was
Falcon. Not me. I fucking promise you that.
Interesting. So, I realized that I liked the Falcon the minute that one of his wings got ripped off, and I went, oh, no! And then I thought, oh, crap, I actually care about this guy.
I wasn't a huge Falcon fan until this most recent watch. But with this watch, and probably with a lot of the context that comes within Civil War, like, I see that their friendship is, like, legitimate. When they, you know, when they meet and they start to, like, Steve starts walking away and he's like, it's your bed, isn't it? And they talk about sleeping in war worlds or whatever.
Well, so if we're talking other characters, I wanted to call out Natasha Romanoff. I felt like this is one of the best examples of Natasha Romanoff that we get in these series of movies. I really enjoyed her as a spy. It makes sense that she would be really successful in this story because that's what her role is. I like that she was simultaneously the bad guy and the good guy. And at the end of the movie, you may think that Captain America is saving the day, but the truth is that the person who actually solves the problems in this movie is Natasha Romanoff when she reveals all of S.H.I.E.L.D.'s secrets and shuts down both S.H.I.E.L.D. and Hydra at the same time. She's
the
one who saves
the
day.
Like, they mentioned to her that, like, Alexander Pierce is like, hey, so, you know, this is also going to give all your information away, too. And then she, I can't remember the line, but it was a good, like good comeback to Robert Redford's character.
Exactly. And I felt like she really came into her own in this movie, and that was awesome. That was really successful for me.
I thought she was a fine Pepper Potts.
Sorry, go ahead, Adifa.
She's never been hotter. Like, I was looking at her, and I was actually like,
I said that earlier. Wow. Not on the recording here, but I was remarking off.
I'm telling you guys,
offline about that.
A confident girl is sexy as all get out.
Oh, it wasn't that. Like that's great and all, but her particular figure and shape.
Yeah, it was like was on wearing, top.
There was one even better than scene Avengers where she was like, okay, it's when they meet up in the hospital and he pushes her in the room. And was like, what the fuck? There was one part like where like she has this a side profile, and I was like, Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Cristo.
Where she tells the story of when she got shot, and she's like, and I can't wear a bikini anymore. And he's like, yeah, I bet you look awful in a bikini.
Honestly, yeah. Part of me was hoping Cap fucking banged her. Seriously. I'm like, God, I would love to see that in this movie.
It does bring us to the important question from Captain America, where she says, are you the first person you've kissed? Am I the first person you've kissed since you were unfrozen? And he was like, no.
She said, since like 1944.
Yeah, since 1944. Yeah.
So I'm on the complete opposite end of the spectrum with you guys with Black Widow in this. So I've never really liked Black Widow as a character, and I didn't really start appreciating her until we most recently, till our discussion about Avengers. I really like her in Avengers. And I feel like one of the reasons I dislike her so much is because of Winter Soldier. So, you know, when we talk about how in every single movie, she's like playing a different love interest, you know, in Iron Man 2, she's like, to me, it is that's her Black Widow skill set. Like some things that she just doesn't have the ability to turn off within herself. And this movie, to me, makes that not seem true. It makes it like it seems like she has a legitimate interest in Cap. That, like,
you don't?
Well, of course I do. Of course I do. But she kind of plays up her, she doesn't play up her sexuality. She plays up like a real person who has an attraction to someone who like wants to have a relationship.
Oh, but if you are going to attract Captain America, you are not doing it with your body. You are doing it with your upstanding American morals.
No, that is 100% true.
You attract him. So she would need to,
even though person he loves more than anyone is British, but still,
but you see my point.
I'm just giving you shit. You're 100% correct. Coats.
So if her power as a Black Widow character is to be the thing that is sexy to whoever she's being with, then she was doing that for him.
She was, but that to me, it seemed like it was a real version of her.
Yeah.
And I did not like, I more prefer the relationship that she has with Bruce Banner in Age of Ultron, because that seems a lot more real to me. And we'll talk about that in 2 weeks, real to me.
The whole, hey there, big guy. Sun's going down makes my fucking skin crawl.
There's nothing wrong, I mean, for her to want the dick.
That's fair. This seems like a completely different Natasha Romanoff than what we get in all the other movies. And then talk about her being hot. To me, this is the worst haircut she's ever had in a movie. Outside of Iron Man 2, where it's completely flat. It doesn't have layers in it. She just like gets straight scissors and like cuts it all the way around. It's like it's a long bowl cut. All
right. So in
G.I. Joe. And then it has a part like right in the middle.
So in G.I. Joe.
I'm down with my chicks looking like long haired Dee Dee Ramone.
In G.I. Joe, they had sort of a problem where they had 16, 18 guys and they had one girl. Her name was Scarlet. And all of those guys, whenever you were playing G.I. Joe, were all fighting over Scarlet. And
she was like the Smurfette.
She was like the Smurfette of G.I. Joe's. But here's the thing. She had very similar hair to Scarlett Johansson in the show.
Yeah.
So I am predisposed to liking that particular hairstyle.
Yeah, that haircut does not work for me.
I think
Natalie
that's
Portman
me
in
well.
Thor the Dark World, much better.
I really don't like curly haired. I like, you know, straight hair. So
I'm not saying
curly hair man either.
Put some layers in it. Put some work into your hair.
I don't want fucking Little Orphan Annie. I want Scarlett Johansson. I want Black Widow.
then you can have Black Widow from any of the other movies where she has good hair, except for Iron Man 2. Iron Man 2, it looks ridiculous.
All right, whatever, man.
Yeah. But yeah, outside of that, like, I don't know. She wasn't super interesting in this to me. And she gets...
fuck? Hey, let's just disregard that.
All the everybody who's listening to this is like, oh, because he had to grab the microphone. That
I
always
think
sounds
Pep
wonderful.
Just finished.
Sorry, that was just me thinking about Scarlett Johansson.
That wasn't even Pep. That was DKP.
That was DKP.
That's my genuine cry of fear. If you've never heard of it, never heard it.
Let me tell you, when I finish, you'll know. I defy. You'll know.
Ooh.
But yeah, shout out to Pep's mom.
She just wasn't. She didn't work for me in this movie as much as I hoped. And it's specifically the scene. It's funny, like when my prior impressions of this movie before the 1,000 rewatches I did was, I remember the only part that I didn't like was similar to what you guys are talking about with the Arnim Zola stuff. Like the middle of the movie was like the weakest part to me. And like they're the scene when they are at the boot camp and the scene prior to it when they're heading to the boot camp, when they're in the car together. And Cap like makes the comment about like her taking her feet off the dash, and it's where she has the conversation with him about the last time he got a kiss and all that kind of stuff. Like those two scenes together used to not work for me. Now the Arnim Zola scene definitely works for me, but that them in the car traveling to New Jersey
doesn't work for you.
Didn't work. Still incredible. Mm-hmm. But didn't work.
So the other character that I really wanted to talk about that I felt finally got his own in this movie was Nick Fury.
Hell yes.
I disagree. Yeah. I think Nick Fury should have his own movie.
Oh, I agree. 100%.
You can never give Nick Fury enough screen time.
And shit, you could make the entire movie Nick Fury escapes from a Suburban. I mean, you could make a whole movie on
that
topic.
That scene is incredible.
Yeah, that was...
When
the best action scene probably in the movie.
The scene where, like, the
except for when
computer...
he got stopped, and then guess what happened? About 11 men just sat there and shot him with guns for like 2.5 hours. But leading up to that and afterwards, it was great.
My favorite line in that scene is where he's telling the car, well, what's functional? And the car says, oh, the air conditioning.
The air conditioning. To be honest, though, that is the most important part.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, that scene where it's in that scene whenever the window integrity is going down percentages, and then they're like, do you want me to put on auto defense mode or whatever? And he's like, no, not yet. Not yet. And then it's like 1%. Then he's like, put it on. And then he fucking gets that gun that comes out of the center console, turns. Oh my gosh. So badass. Just starts destroying
and
everybody.
What I realized this time is why he was waiting. He was getting all those guys to get in a funnel right in front of him. Yeah. He was just positioning those dudes to where he wanted. He didn't want to pop the thing out and have them all scatter before he got a chance to shoot them. All of that passed me right by the first time. But this time I was like, oh man.
Nick
Fury knows what he's doing.
I mean, it's also like you're gonna blow your load real
waiting
early.
For the shield,
you have to wait
to get
longer
so
time
low
for it to get. Sorry, go on.
That he finally was able to shoot everybody through it.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, there's also like if you have to wait till there's repairs or whatever the flight systems are back online, you better milk the shit out of that window while you can.
That's true.
That's exactly what I thought.
Buy time. I mean, it's both, but. I mean, the thing is, it's just Samuel Jackson is top tier. He's the master of monologues. He's the master at yelling. I mean, that's what he does. And like he goes from like best yelling with, "No, stop it, not yet." Every line is tense. It's delivered with expert perfection, cooked golden brown. You know what I'm saying? Then you get the monologue about his granddad with the
crumble. Oh, that was so good.
Yeah, that's when I was really thinking. Like, he's the master of monologuing. Like, he's the fucking best at everything.
And he had a character arc. He didn't really have that much to do in this movie, but he changed.
No, he had a great arc.
Throughout this movie, he starts out being kind of full of himself and a little hubris, and I'm going to build these guns, and I'm going to, you know, do this. And Captain America's like,
freedom.
That's not freedom. That's yeah. Man, that's messed up. But then in the middle of the movie, he's like, oh, shit, I might have screwed up here. And Captain America's like, oh, I think you screwed up. And he's like, oh, dude, you got me, fam. That's why I'm here. I screwed up.
I guess I did.
And then at the
up.
End, he's still changing. He's like, okay, we're not going to be doing S.H.I.E.L.D. I need to figure out what I'm going to be doing next, and I'm going to go off and I'm going to do that. That, as an actor, to be able to bring me along that journey with such little to work with. Brilliant.
No, I don't think there's much that you can't understate how phenomenal Samuel fucking Jackson is. Yeah. So if you replaced every character in the Marvel Universe with Samuel Jackson, I'd be completely fine with it.
I didn't like him in the Avengers at all. And this movie, I absolutely adore him. Like, he feels like his own character. He feels like he has a purpose. And like I said, we get some backstory about him where he talks about his granddad.
We do.
In the
if that's true. Him as an actor has got a commanding presence just when he speaks. If you want, just as a side note, if you guys want a good example of that, there's a movie called The Sunset Limited, which stars simply just him and Tommy Lee Jones in a room talking.
Oh, cool.
That sounds amazing.
But it's one of the most tense, like, incredible, well-written movies. I don't want to go into what it's about, but definitely check it out.
I got to say, my favorite Sam Jackson is Hateful Eight.
Yeah, he fucking killed it in that.
Have you guys seen Black Snake Moan?
Of course I have. Oh, Christina Ricci? Yeah.
He is brilliant in that movie.
Yep.
So very good. He like plays the guitar and sings the blues in it.
Nice.
And it's like actually Samuel L. Jackson, and oh man, perfect.
What fucking can't he do? Am I right, boys?
I don't know. Speaking of an elevator, one of my favorite action scenes is the elevator scene, and everybody starts getting on, and then he looks over and he sees the guy has his hand on the gun, and then he looks over and sees the dude perspiring, and then the next group of guys on, he goes, "Hey guys, before we get started, does anybody want to get off?" Like, because everybody knows what's about to go down, and then it is just a fucking brutal knockdown, drag-out fight.
That scene
in
was
an
awesome.
Elevator.
That scene is brilliant, and it's an example of the director putting you in the shoes of Captain America. Like, I felt every moment of tension as that tension
built. I wonder what
would have
happened if he just gotten off the elevator, though.
With all those
douchebags in, and he just walks out.
It was followed up. You know, he jumps out of the window, and then he gets on his Harley Davidson motorcycle.
Oh, but hold on a second here. I'm playing Zelda right now, and I just want to say that when he went out that window with that shield, in my head I went, jump, shield, shield ride. All right. So there's a move like that right in Zelda. Yeah. I was like, I know how to do that.
See, like I said, those are the scenes that like worked really well for me action-wise.
I even loved him taking out the Quinjet.
Yeah, the Quinjet, whenever he, like, immediately after that scene, he gets on the motorcycle and he's driving. And it has this ridiculous, you want to talk about, like, suspending disbelief and very comic book movie.
It was stupid, but,
like,
you know.
Oh, it was so
I met it halfway.
Where he's throwing
the
shield
elevator
between
scene, they
between
had some
the,
leeway with me.
Yeah, where he's throwing the shield, like, between the wings of the ship, and it's, like, bouncing back and forth. And then he just hangs on the side of it. Yeah, very cool scene. I had to rewatch
that
I
love
scene
fucking
today.
Seeing him fucking throw that goddamn shield and ping-ponging back. I wish they would explain how he gets it back. Like, if there's a magnet that he kind of triggers.
Do you want to know how he does it?
Yeah, how does that happen?
So, according to the lore in the comic book...
Are we about to start talking about vibranium again?
Well, sort of. It is that he is not only enhanced in his body, but in his mind. And he has, and I swear to God, super trigonometry. And what he's able to do is to calculate where the shield is going to bounce off and land and put himself in that position using his super strength and agility.
If we were talking about anybody other than Captain America, I'd be like, that's the dumbest thing
I've
ever
heard. No, it is the dumbest thing I've ever
heard. But since we're talking about Cap, I'm like,
no,
perfect.
It works worse because it is Cap, because he's oftentimes clueless about everything, yet he knows
exactly
super trigonometry. You know what, in my headcanon, it's
clueless?
Like a Peter... Dude,
what is he clueless about?
He's always like fucking
Cap
mostly half
know.
Fucking stupid. Because he's 40, 90 years old or whatever. That's so a lot of what's going on.
I'm sorry, trigonometry has not changed a lot in 90 years.
What are you talking about?
What I mean is
just the amount of information he has in
a lot of times he doesn't perceive shit better than most people or than other people on the team. Like, he has. This is the one movie where, like, he comes to revelations before other people. But oftentimes it's other people feeding him info.
I think that he just he's culturally ignorant, not necessarily. And they did a good job in this one making him less culturally ignorant. But I don't see him so much as being not perceptual, but I will say they don't emphasize it.
So in my headcanon, just like the magnet that's on his back that holds the shield, he's got some shit that pulls back to him.
It's always really cool whenever he like hits the shield and then he throws his arm through the two armbands and catches it.
I'm down with that when he uses like a kickstand like a skateboard and knocks people out with it.
I have to agree with DKP. The prime scene that, you know, he obviously is completely clueless about is his neighbor is not a SHIELD agent. Like, how do you not know?
Did you notice that she was talking to her aunt on the phone?
I did. I had not seen that before.
Yeah, she's having a conversation with her aunt. And we figure out who her aunt is in Civil War.
Oh.
I mean, I said her first and last name. See, in
you
the cast,
talked about so. Taking out the Quinjets?
Yeah.
Called Quinjets?
I didn't say that word. Pep said that word. It's, I don't know what they're called.
Twinjet or Quinjet?
I think they're Quinn. They're named after the guy who built them, Quinn.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
I'm not sure. I have no basis for saying that you are correct or incorrect.
Sorry. I will look that
there
up.
There are Marvel fans out there who are listening to this and are these guys are
correct me if I got
morons.
That wrong. But
yeah, let us know in the comments.
We can be fucking morons.
The history
and still watch
of the Quinjet.
Let's talk about the helicarriers and the plan. Like the big
I think
plan.
You've already touched on that quite a bit.
Yeah, but I'd like to talk about it.
Okay, go ahead.
Because we've talked about it in a couple ones where it's like, where it's like, hey, where was S.H.I.E.L.D. during this? During Iron Man 3? Why the fuck didn't he just like, hey, let me just call my friend Tony? Because like, honestly, that's what doesn't make sense to me. Like, remember how easy it was to take out the helicarriers in the first one? You just fuck up the engines, right? I don't
it's
understand like, the three helicarriers. That's such a shitty plan. Like,
I'm sorry. I apologize. I just looked this up, and this is very cool, actually.
All right.
So the Quinjet was originally designed. Get this. Oh, stupid.
By Arnim Zola. No, I don't know.
By Stark, I believe. Stark and Shield.
No, Wakanda.
Arnim Zoloft. Wakanda.
Stupid. Sorry, my page
Billy
wrote over
Crystal.
Itself. Please go on. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, you got it?
Nope.
Okay, let me know what you do. But yeah,
I got it in front of me. It's Stark and S.H.I.E.L.D. built the Quinjet, and that ship that he took down was a Quinjet.
Okay,
and it's actually been in a couple movies.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was in the comic books as well.
Yeah.
But go on, I'm sorry.
Am I the only person who thinks Hydra's plan just to shoot everybody was stupid?
I thought that as well. I thought it was pretty stupid.
Well, two things. One, their plan wasn't to shoot everybody.
Their plan was to be the minority report. Project Insight.
So their plan was to shoot only the people who were going to be
superpowers. Millions of people. So like just shooting everybody. Like just constant barraging of shooting people on the ground.
It is one of those things. It's like, how do they plan to like keep themselves clean?
All right, so I get where they were going with this. What they were doing is they were trying to talk about how drones are not a very ethical way to perform war. And so they were creating the Marvel Universe version of the way that Americans do drone warfare.
Yeah, this movie is very like, I remember watching this movie when it came out and noticing the relevance that it had to like where we were socially, because the big thing socially back then was like the government spying on us and the government knowing, being able to use our cell phone records and everything. And like, how free are we? The fact that they know every single thing about us, like, you know, socially we've evolved. It's still kind of there. Stuff like,
well, the Patriot Act still isn't able. I mean, still,
yeah,
it's not.
But it was a big point of conversation back in 2014.
And so I think that what they were trying to do was to sort of make some points about that, and that's why they picked this particular weapon. But I will say this, one of the things I was disappointed in this movie was I was kind of tired of seeing helicarriers get shot out of the sky. I felt like that was just going back to an old trope. We could have done this in a different way that would have been way more interesting.
Now, I agree with DKP when he said like, you could have just taken them. You could have taken them out as opposed to reprogram them.
Absolutely, and that's another thing. This really
reprogrammed
stupid
them first. I'm like, hey, they're under our control now. Now let's kill them.
That's what I'm saying. Like you didn't have to. You didn't have to reprogram.
Just plant bombs.
Just destroy them.
It's
that just bugged me was this giant, stupidly designed ball on the bottom of the helicarrier designed for...
Well, Peb, you have to have a skylight for everyone who's not guarding... Everyone who's not guarding the power cores to look through it.
It was a great reason. It's three helicarriers, three main superheroes. It's like perfectly lining itself up to be this like...
I get that. It just was so dumb to think of as a... Like, just as a design standpoint. My computer needs to be able to watch what's going on below it. I don't know. It made no sense to me.
Here's a fun bit.
These guys have killed a god or successfully fought a god in space bugs and an entire invasion from another universe. We're going to take over the world with these three helicarriers. No. Boo. I don't know, just the whole, like, that's Hydra's big plan. Like, you, one jet, one Iron Man, one Hulk, one anything could well, take out these. Well, you're flying around shooting people endlessly.
But no one was supposed to know that they were doing this.
And you guys did
see... They were trying to kill everybody who knew about it.
You guys did see Tony Stark's cameo in this, right?
No.
Yeah, he has a screen.
He has a screen. So when they do the targeting... Threats. Tony Stark comes up. So Tony Stark would have been taken out in the first volley. So there's
Hulk wouldn't have, though.
Okay, so Hulk was a good example.
But that's the thing,
example.
Though. Like, there's no way they could do
this
shit covertly because they're flying over Manhattan shooting people. Like, well, you're going to know pretty fucking immediately.
Well, no, they wouldn't have to fly over Manhattan to do it.
Their algorithm is stupid, even considering Doctor Strange. Like, how could you even possibly think that he is a threat? It is fucking dumb, especially now that we know in the future his origin.
We had this conversation. We had this, DKP and I had this conversation. Go ahead, DKP.
So, I guess I just have a different understanding or a different interpretation or maybe a misinterpretation of what it is, what this algorithm is supposed to do. So, Stephen Strange, is, to my understanding, at that point in the film, is known only as kind of a degenerate. He's a full of himself, famous... Playboy
surgeon.
He is surgeon.
Incredibly talented.
Yeah, he's well known as a surgeon, though.
Yes, he is an incredibly talented
there's no way
individual
there's no way that
who
they...
has a predisposition for, like, being a piece of shit. And, like, has the potential or ability if he, like, he has the potential if he goes down the wrong path that he could, you know.
The algorithm gets to him and goes, this is just like Iron Man. Kill him.
See, that's what I don't get. It's like, that'd be like saying, oh, Charlie Sheen could be a threat to the United States government. Better right. Get him.
So if we were, I think that would be a legit thing for this program to do. Another thing it would do is if you were in the DC world, it would have gone after all the orphanages. Oh my God, you might turn out like Batman. Yeah. We're gonna kill every single kid who's
all
lost
these
his parents
that don't have parents.
We think we have information that leads us to believe this man might get in a car accident and become Sorcerer Supreme.
But it's something now. Again, it goes back to what I was talking about with, like, 2014, and we've talked about this before, like, you and I, Adifi, have talked about this, I think, when you were visiting Austin, where we talked about how the government knows so much about us. Like, they know what we spend our money on, and they know, like, where we I don't know, like, everything that we watch, anytime that we watch porn, they
know
all
everywhere
of our
we
habits.
Go in the Uber,
they know every single thing about every single one of us, at least in the United States of America. And imagine using all of that information to be able to say, like, let's look at historically, since we have that, if, let's say, for example, I don't know, let's say there's this guy named Adam, and Adam has this he does all these things, he has this normal life, he lives this life, and then he goes on a rampage and, like, shoots up a school. But you can take that information from Adam and say, like, how many people are also living... It's like a FBI profiler.
Yep.
If you've watched that show Mindhunter, it's like, how do we prevent future crimes from happening based on what we can recognize about people with these types of things?
I don't think that they thought he was going to be Sorcerer Supreme. I thought they thought he was going to do something incredible, and that's what they were trying to stop.
Okay, see,
that's also,
so
I don't...
The
I don't
argue, yeah,
I
okay, so
that.
You have an explanation for that. But then... Okay, first off, Hulk is the exception. Obviously, we know he's tried to kill himself. How the hell are they going to do that? And if Hydra has been in S.H.I.E.L.D. from the beginning, which is a complete fucking stretch, why would they even allow the Avengers to fucking form?
They tried to stop it. That's why they, like...
Yeah, that was in the Avengers. Remember the four guys... The three of those guys are in Hydra. The people who appear on the screens, they're all in Hydra. And all they did through the Avengers was say, you can't put together this team. What are you doing? In fact, all they did in the previous after credits scenes, there was an after credits scene where they said, you can't, don't put together these Avengers. And Nick Fury is like, fuck you, I'm putting these Avengers together.
Right,
and,
but at and, the same time, if that is,
the,
if they
the
now
the council
have,
not part of Hydra, it turns out?
No.
They are in the show. Like, in the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. show, you end up finding out that some of those council members are actually S.H.I.E.L.D. agents.
Yeah, they all come back as
But their plan after the fact is just retarded.
So Robert Redford was playing a double con with them?
Even the Thor aspect of it. They have these helicarriers that come out and shoot everybody that's a potential threat. So Thor, Hulk alone will be able to destroy these things.
Yes, but
it is such a stupid-ass plan after Avengers have already been formed.
Hulk and Thor and Tony Stark and all of these other people have no idea. No one knows that S.H.I.E.L.D. has fucking Hydra in it.
Yeah. And but what I'm saying is...
The people who do know...
You're saying that their Hydra plan wouldn't have worked even if Captain America had not taken them out. Well, I agree. It was a crappy-ass plan, but I'm still glad that Captain America took them out before they were able to
wipe out millions of people
didn't
die. I'm with you there.
They would have succeeded in the first round. They wouldn't have been able to kill any more people.
Yeah, yeah. Like, and then the Hulk would have shown up and taken them out.
Again, I don't think their plan was a bad thing. I think the fact that we didn't know what their plan was after... We didn't know how they intended to, like...
Make the most of that situation.
Speak to this. It's like, hey, I think they said 3 million people was what they planned on killing. Hey, why did 3 million people just get shot out of the sky by a United States government, like, equipment? What just happened? And, you know, they would have had to have a big explanation on their hand. But, like,
I mean,
figuring
even,
out what their actual
even the
plan
fact that,
is... What their actual
okay,
plan
but even
is,
when
I don't
their
think
plan,
it's...
Even when their plan goes through... That's in what? I mean, yes, I'm assuming Washington, D.C. Okay, a bunch of people in Washington, D.C. die. That's not saying Stark's not in Washington, D.C. That's not saying Hulk's not in California. I mean, it's fucking dumb.
No, we see that shot that shows where all the X's are.
Yeah, they're all over the world.
Yeah. It's not just Washington, D.C.
Those helicarriers
are
just going
to
start in one
they
place and
to
move.
Fly around continuously just shooting people for,
satellites involved to help
I
find
do
want to
point out that their plan was the exact same plan as the Crimson Skull from the first Captain America movie. Its plan was fly around the world, drop bombs, or kill a bunch of people in the various cities around the world.
And
it's
who
basically
has the
same
plan. What people on Earth have the ability to be a threat to Hydra taking...
Back in the 40s, really nobody. So that kind of could have worked. But nowadays, where there's gods and fucking Iron Man and who the fuck knows
like
what...
I feel like every plot hole that you guys are dropping, me and Peb are covering.
Yep.
We're covering all the plot holes that you're talking about.
You're covering them in such a way that isn't even plausible. It's just not. I mean, they
no,
get the...
But
the
no, you were just saying that they're the only after people in Washington, D.C. when we clearly saw that they were after more people than Washington, D.C.
Well, like, yes, obviously, we actually but there's only three helicarriers and there's tons of threats.
No,
so
look,
you're telling
are.
Me
look,
they...
Satellites.
I'm assuming,
look,
I'm assuming they're going to kill the main ones first.
Do me a favor
kill the main
and be sober
first.
And rewatch this movie.
Look.
And you'll see all the stuff that you're missing.
I
the
feel three like you guys are white knighting Hydra in this whole thing. Their plan from the
Hydra
beginning
agents.
Was just flat out stupid.
These things launch from fucking, what is it, New York? Because they're near Jersey? Like they're up in like
the
helicarriers
are in Washington D.C.
Okay,
they are currently in Washington D.C.
All right, so yeah, like they have all their targets,
and their intention
was
to fire from Washington D.C. But it works. Like I don't know if you guys knew this about technology, but we have the ability to set a target in any place on planet Earth from any place on planet Earth.
So
and
what
fire
exactly were they firing? Missiles? Were we gonna have long range missiles,
you,
or
you
was
saw,
it?
They were big guns.
It's a
so
combination.
Were they curve
it's a
these
combination
around
of,
the world.
Yep, it's parabolic, shooting. It's been around since the 1800s.
You mean like from Washington to New York?
Yeah, Washington, New York's easy.
But like you don't want to kill civilians because that's not what like...
No, they definitely do
want
to
kill civilians.
No, only
the
bad ones.
Well, Hydra
not
was going
to... Not the ones that have the potential to be bad.
Yeah, so you're going to be able to
I don't think that they were real concerned about casualties. They weren't incidental casualties. I think they were going to
like
take
said,
out lots
it,
of people.
It just seems far too... Like, and honestly, okay, this is one where it's like, yeah, it seems too unplausible, too stupid. Especially for people who, A, have fucking Loki's scepter, you're going to set that up and then be like, oh, so you just had that as a backup? That wasn't
your
go-to?
I think that what you're saying holds a lot of weight if you also have that same problem with Red Skull in World War II. Because his goal is to accomplish the same thing. The technology's just different.
Right, but at the same time, that was literally flying and dropping the technology we have today to basically wipe out. That was real warfare that happened. And that also disregards
like,
completely
it's like what
the superheroes that we
drones.
Have in the universe, in the Marvel MCU today, which you didn't have Thor, you didn't have Iron Man, you only had Captain America. That was it. It's the only superhero around at that time. So yeah, it could have worked then.
You had Black Panther.
But I mean, they weren't going to do anything.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's a separate.
I'm just saying
plot hole of like.
Again, I think the plot hole is.
I don't think it's one or the other.
I don't think the plot hole is associated with their plan.
I don't necessarily think it's a plot hole. I just think it's fucking stupid.
The fact that we don't know how they intend to survive this
and make
I think
the most out of
it. That's the big plot hole. Is like let's say that they pulled it off. What's their next step? How do they prevent Iron Man and Thor and Hulk and all these people from coming to get them after they do it?
We don't know what their plans
but
were.
That's where I think the big plot hole is. I don't think the plot hole exists within their plan itself. It's the post.
Oh no! Like I said, I just think the plan is fucking stupid. I think the whole setup for like
then
all
Hitler's
the three
plan was
the three. Yeah, it didn't
Red
work.
Red Skull's plan was stupid, and it should have been something that you complained about in regards to. World
I don't
War
see
II.
How you don't see the difference.
If you could explain the difference,
I've
to
been
me,
explaining if, the difference.
If you could explain it in a way that made sense, then.
Okay, you know what? We'll talk afterwards.
Saying,
otherwise, we're going to be sitting on this, and this is going to be a 2-hour long
no,
podcast.
No, but the difference is...
Hammering
the
home
difference
shitty
is
details.
They're in a different world now. The difference between the first Avenger to now is you don't have those X, Y, and Z superheroes. You don't have the X Factor. That's the difference.
So did you... In this version of reality that you guys have created... Tony Stark knows that Hydra's planned this, and the plot hole is that Tony Stark knows that this is happening and is doing nothing about it?
Not well, that he doesn't know.
First of all,
he
I mean,
obviously
Captain
doesn't
America
trust
and Nick
them.
Fury probably have his fucking
well,
phone
no,
number.
He doesn't know. He doesn't know, and neither does Bruce
no, no,
Banner,
no.
and neither does
no,
Thor.
No, no, no.
They're off all dealing with and doing
that.
Their own things.
No, it's not that he doesn't know. He doesn't trust them, and they established that in the first Avengers. Cap
but,
even
so
figured
he,
that
so,
out in the first
so
Avengers.
So where do you see Iron Man fitting in? Fill this plot hole for me, where Iron Man fits into this story.
I don't think Stark is going to easily, especially after what happened in the third Iron Man, he's not going to let some ship out of nowhere shoot the crap out of him. Sorry, it's just not going to happen. Not
yeah,
with him being
he,
able
he,
to call the armor at his, just a thought. It's not going to happen.
Did he know that those
and
ships
then the
were in the air?
The bullets, missiles, etc. aren't going to kill Banner. Banner alone
know?
Will destroy everything.
Yeah, he absolutely would. He absolutely
but that's
would.
Why, but that is exactly why the plan is moronic. And like I said, I'm not...
Right,
actually,
but you're
I
not
agree
saying,
with BKB. It's a moronic plan.
You're not saying the plan... You couldn't
it's
do
like,
the plan. You're just saying it's a dumb plan.
Yes, and not only
that's
that, it's
I've
not
been
even
saying.
Original. They already but, failed the first time. Why
exactly.
are they going to do it again?
I don't know why do people conquest the world in 2014? We've had people take over parts of the
Jesus.
World
all right,
for
look,
thousands of
fucking,
years.
Okay, there's a difference between legit. Okay, what the Red Skull was doing was legit, like military strategy, which is you take out basically strongholds like Berlin, like fucking Washington.
Yeah.
So imagine like that. So that way you can then move your armies in to take over those places once their military has been demolished.
Right.
Meanwhile, you're talking about having helicarriers. Pilot Tony Stark and his shitter in a building somewhere, shoot a big ass bullet that curves around the earth, flies into the shitter, hits him, and then fucking like all that technology, but you know where he's at, you know
yes,
exactly
that technology
that
exists
fucking,
right now in America.
No, not to that degree where you can
okay.
fucking track somebody inside of a goddamn building, hit them from Washington, like through whatever building that they're in, hit them from that does not exist, not on a scale we can do millions at a time.
I feel bad for our listeners because Peb's face is telling so many stories about it's like, DKP, how do you not understand that this stuff exists?
Yeah, this is straight up drone warfare. Now, I will say it's been comicified. You can't do, you know, millions at once.
So when they fly drones, if there's a man inside a building, we don't know exactly where he's at in that building. We
yeah.
can blow up the entirety of the building.
Which is
but
what
I don't
do.
Think they were going to be shooting just missiles. We saw the weaponry that was on the ships, and it was bullets.
Yeah, yeah. Big guns that take out buildings.
Yes. So, unless they're... My point is, if they're wanting to demolish everything,
yes.
they should just drop fucking bombs. Bombs or missiles, nukes,
agreed.
Basically, which is what the Red Skull was kind of gonna do.
Yeah, but
this is like precision level.
The difference is that we have the technology for the precision level stuff now.
And we didn't then.
And we didn't think.
We don't have that the technology they were going to use in the way that that it was implied they were going to use it in this movie. We do not have
now,
that.
Now we're going back to what the plot hole is. And the plot hole is
no,
that
it's not
this
a plot
technology
hole
shouldn't
in
exist.
No,
again, this is about suspending disbelief.
The fuck, Jesus.
Why are you getting so mad?
Because you're wanting to defend it, and I'm just saying. I even said it earlier. It's not a plot hole. I just think it's fucking stupid.
Oh yeah, I agree.
But if we're arguing about the technology not existing in real life, I'll argue that. But it's in a comic book. Iron Man doesn't exist in real life. But like I've said this time and time again, there's no plot hole to me. I just think it's fucking stupid.
Agreed. You think it's stupid that they want to take a bunch of people out?
I think it's stupid, the whole deal with the helicarriers, how they're going to shoot Tony Stark in his shitter in New York from fucking Washington. I just think the whole thing is fucking dumb.
Huh. Because I, on the other hand, find the idea of me riding to a wedding and having my car destroyed from miles away before I even know it happens is a horrifying idea. And it happens regularly in the course of the way we wage war right now. And I think that they were trying to... The thing that they were trying to appeal to, I think, is that sense of they're coming to get you. And that's what this was trying to sort of explain, is how frightening that is, that I have to, like, they're after me, so now I have to keep away from all my family and friends because I don't want them to take out all of them when they take me out. And I think that they were trying to talk about how horrifying and how frightening that experience might be, and in a way that Americans could relate to.
I see. I can understand that, but I don't, that wasn't effectively communicated to me. So, I mean, maybe that is what they were going for. That's not what I got out of it. I could see the whole, a connection with, like, drone warfare in its entirety. Like, I could see that.
I think that they weren't being so blatant about it in an effort to make this a little more commercial. So, like, you can't just flat out attack we have pilots that are flying drones right now. We can't just say, oh, you know, fuck those drone guys, because, you know, they're doing
like
stuff.
The whole thing is basically explained by the algorithm. And like once again, that's like, oh, shut
the algorithm.
Fuck up.
The algorithm is used to identify the people. It's not used to fire the missile at someone. It's used to say who to fire the missile at.
It's supposed to do that. It's supposed to, I guess, track their body
Project
literally
Insight.
Enough to the specific building that they're in, even though you haven't identified them going in.
That's not
in.
What the algorithm is for. The algorithm is to identify the people.
But when it had the coordinates for each people,
this is what
Tony Stark
the way
flies
it,
all over
so
the place
the way
constantly.
They explained it, them getting the coordinates for the people, was when they talked about how everything that you do is tracked. Zoloff spends, I get his name wrong every time.
It's also talked about, Nick Fury
Zoloff.
Has the conversation.
Nick Fury talks about it?
Nick Fury,
Zoloff,
and Steve have the conversation, and that's when Steve makes that's not freedom. That's fear.
Right, but Zoloff makes the same comment. He says, you know, every time you buy something, every time you do something at all.
I get that. But as far as a precision strike, like one bullet, one hit kill guaranteed, like we'll hit our mark unless they're just going to be Gatling gunning across the, you know, Midwest.
So again, your problem is the technology.
I think it's dumb. I mean, the whole like how much like what they're trying to do as far as like how much I have to suspend disbelief. I can, but I think the plan in general is fucking stupid.
Cool. I think their long-term plan was dumb, but.
I think their long-term plan is the issue. I think their short-term plan is just to kill a bunch of people.
I don't doubt that they can succeed in killing a bunch of people. Sure.
This is the last thing I'm going to say about that plan. Let's say they did succeed. What is the aftermath of that?
That's what
Let's
we were talking
Stark
about 30 minutes ago.
Happened to survive. If he did survive...
They don't have a plan afterwards.
Hydra is wiped off the face of the earth if they 100%. Pull that fucking stunt. It is stupid idea.
That's why it's a bad idea, is because they don't have or at least we as the viewer don't get an idea of what the post plan is. The plan itself, not a terrible idea. It's a plan that people have been after forever, which is kill your enemies.
Yeah.
And this is Minority Report of kill your potential enemies. The plan itself is not bad. It's something that exists within people all over the world. The plan is how does South Korea intend to shoot a fire nuclear weapon at the United States of America without the United States of America wiping South Korea off the face of the earth?
North Korea, but yeah.
Well, yeah, no, North Korea, sorry. South Korea's great.
Yeah, yeah.
I love Psy, man. Yeah, Psy's awesome.
There you go.
He's got a song in Black Panther, actually.
About Samsung. You know what I mean?
I do like Samsung.
I like Samsung products.
I'm a big fan of Samsung.
Yeah. We're Samsung boys here.
I mean, I have the LG TVs and an iPhone. So
My phone's a Samsung. Totally. Yeah.
So you mean you love North Korea then?
That is exactly.
If you don't buy Samsung, then you support North Korea.
But it's the same sort of idea of like, would it be stupid for Kim Jong-un to fire a missile at the United States of America? Yes, it would be stupid. It would absolutely be stupid because we would wipe him off the face of the earth.
Is he still going to do it?
Would he still try it?
Probably.
I don't know, man.
Yeah, but that's assuming, rightfully so, that Kim Jong-un is fucking stupid. Hydra's not supposed to be stupid.
And you're saying the Hustler dude, shit, what's his name? Robert Redford didn't look that dumb to you?
No, not really.
Still handsome. Still handsome.
By the way, he was really good in this movie.
You assume they're all fucking really stupid, but simply just like they spent all their points in like charisma and deception, but no intelligence.
Because Armin's masters at deception,
but nothing else. I guess is that right?
Arnim Zola's algorithm is to me makes tons of sense, and it like I keep making
it does
the reference
not
to
make
Minority
sense.
Report. The
it
basis
does not
for Minority
make sense
Report
in the world
the
that
thing.
They currently live in. It does not, and 100% does not make sense.
So it made me think a lot of Person of Interest. So it's topics that I've thought about a lot in the past. So it I found this.
No, basically,
very
I get the whole like you're put on a list if you
the
go
government,
to this website. I
so,
get that. But
so imagine like the government right now, and we've talked about this before. Like you go on a terrorist whatever. If you can't say certain words when you're on the phone or whatever. It's all like potential BS.
I'm telling you.
If someone says the word bomb on a phone call,
it's just riling me up. And I'm starting to, this movie is just dropping points for me. I'm telling you. Now that I think about Hydra and this whole thing, it's just pissing me off. Like, not you guys, but their plan just fucking annoys me so much. It's knocking down points.
Man, we almost didn't talk about this. Remember, Tommy, when I said, can we talk about Hydra's plan? You went, we already kind of talked about it. I went, well, hold on.
Well, this is what I was afraid would happen if we continued this conversation, is we'd spend 45 minutes on it and never actually review the movie. But this is how like villains work. This is villain 101 of like, let me destroy people. Let me kill anybody that's a threat. And when you talk about Project Insight being a terrible idea, like the United States government right now can probably tell you within the hours, the next time that you're going to like go to work, the government can tell you where you're going to be on average on Thursday nights at 7 p.m. at 8:30 p.m. Central Standard Time for Preparation 8. They can tell you where you're going to be now. Now imagine if that technology is even better because someone actually spent their life designing something and has been working on it. You know, as a computer brain, has been coming up with an algorithm that has the ability to tell when you're going to go shopping and what your shopping habits are and what your bathing habits are, whatever. If the government has the ability to do that, which they pretty much do, which is the basis for why this movie worked, especially in 2014.
I don't think anybody's disputing that, though. I think you said
Project Insight is stupid.
I'll say this.
Yes, because you're not taking
into
account the world they exist in. They have Avengers. If we had Avengers,
Project Insight is stupid. Project Insight, the purpose of Project Insight is to tell the future of what an individual is going to do.
I will not answer questions about Project Mayhem.
Yeah, the first
it's not stupid
rule
for
of Project
our world.
Insight is you
for
don't ask questions
makes
about Project 100% Insight.
Sense. But in our world, we don't have a Hulk. They can destroy everything.
Yeah, but just because you have a Hulk doesn't mean that you can't predict when someone's going to take a shit. A Hulk doesn't stop you from being able to predict.
Like I said,
everything
that you're saying about
sometimes
the prediction.
I hold them on purpose.
That's what Project Insight is, man. Project Insight is not a weapon. Project Insight is technology that's used to identify people's future. Project Insight is not stupid. The purpose of Project Insight is not to kill people.
Stop saying
it's to
Project
identify
Insight.
People.
I'd like everyone to know that I take a shit at a different time every day.
Same,
so that I can avoid Project Insight.
Like I said, sometimes I just hold them and I don't know why.
But for you to make the statement that Project Insight's dumb means you didn't know what Project Insight was or what you actually meant was.
I understood exactly why they were using it, and I didn't see it the way you did. I took it as, yes, they gathered all this information like we have now, and they are going to eliminate potential threats. That's what Project Insight was based for, potential threats.
Yes.
And my argument is...
And that's not stupid.
No, in their world, it is dumb. It is 100% dumb. In our world, yes, it makes 100% sense.
Boys, I'm afraid, I think, can we all agree, I think we probably need to move on.
Yeah, we should have moved on when I was like, yeah, we already talked about this. So I blame you for this, TKP.
Hey, man.
Anything else anybody wants to say about the movie?
You guys can't be having private conversations and then not expect them to transfer over here.
No, this isn't a private conversation. This was something that DKP said earlier in the podcast. He said the helicarrier stuff was stupid. And I said, we already talked about that. That was on this podcast.
Oh, no, that was you trying to prevent this.
Yes, I was trying to prevent this.
But then earlier, you know,
because I used Project Insight to identify that this conversation was going to be a waste of time. Two stupid people talking to two stupid people. And it panned out perfectly.
Well, you definitely know how to appeal to a person, Tommy.
Yay. Anything else anybody wants to say about this?
It was fucking
this
stupid.
This dumb movie?
No, like I said, that really was some shit you could just gloss over.
Yeah,
as far as I thought it was stupid. But we have some big time white knights of this movie, which that's fine.
Agreed.
I will defend my favorite movies to the death as well. And this is one of your favorite Marvel movies, right?
Go ahead.
I just disagree. That doesn't mean wrong or you're wrong.
It's fine, but when you like start name calling and bullshitting,
you said White Knight earlier. I didn't.
No, I didn't.
Someone said White Knight, and it wasn't me.
It wasn't me.
It was you. My bad. Sorry, yeah. I thought you said callers. As a joke, I'm White Knight.
No, I didn't say. I'm just saying you guys are White Knighting the movie, and I was just saying that there are a bunch of stupid aspects
of
it.
You say that, but I remember somebody predicted this movie
a
10.
Not anymore.
Yes. Weren't you going to give it a 10 an hour and a half ago?
And if you notice, he's making it based on a personal issue that he has with the other people in the panel.
Not a personal
issue with the movie.
Your review of the movie is fine.
Love the way Idify ranks movies. You are the best critic.
Really sad because this was going to be a 10. It's not a 10 anymore. No way.
Damn, I'm cool. You know, I always said that I respected you for that, where it's like, he's a man who, given a good argument, will say, yeah, you know what, never mind. I was willing to change his opinions.
And now we know he'll do it based on a bad argument,
too.
A bad
argument, too.
No, based on, I think, a good argument.
Man, like I've said many times, one man's Iron Man 2 is another man's Iron Man 3.
One man's Captain America 2 is another man's Hulk. Yep.
I thought you liked how that works.
No, I didn't know. Remember? I liked it when I first watched it like 11 years ago.
Gotcha.
I think I ranked it like a 4.
Anything else that anybody wants to say about this movie before we score it?
I thought it was mostly good, but just the big linchpins of it, like the villain, that was the only parts I didn't like. But yeah, everything else I thought was decently solid.
I enjoyed Redford. I thought he was Redford. One of the things that surprised me was that, or one of the things I remember about this movie is that when I first saw it, it actually surprised me when Redford turned out to be a bad guy.
Whenever he killed his
maid. Yeah.
Yeah, that was crazy.
That was just messed up.
He should have knocked.
And why doesn't he just like, hey, get out of here?
Well, because they needed to show him to be a villain.
I'm not going to fill any more of this. I'm not going to answer.
No, I get it. He's Hydra. It's like no chances. You saw a metal arm man here.
Yeah.
I can't be known to hang out with the lead singer of My Chemical Romance. She's going to be asking for autographs all over the place. I have to kill you, Omarosa.
All right. So let's score this movie.
All right.
Who wants to start?
I'll give it a 6.5.
DKP gives it a 6.5.
Which is higher than I think that I thought I was going to give it last time.
You said 5.5, so yeah.
How about you, Idify?
I hope I didn't lose him.
Yeah, me too.
Well, Tommy, what are you going to score it?
Idify, you there?
Yeah, the audio's cutting out.
What are you going to score this?
It was going to get a 10. That whole shield, that whole Hydra villain shit fucking pissed me off. It's going to get the same that I gave the first cap, an 8. But, I mean, I haven't really said much this episode, but there was a lot of really good stuff in it. The action was incredible. acting was fantastic. You know, there's not much more I can say. It was an 8. It's about the same as much as I liked the first Cap.
So I originally I said a 6 for this, and I gotta say, this was a really good movie. It was not blow me out of the water amazing, but it was an enjoyable movie that I think added a great deal to this universe in ways that I had honestly not given it credit for the first time I saw it. I'm gonna give it an 8.9.
Ooh, very nice.
Tommy? It's just short of an A quality one.
I was going to give it a 9.7, but after the discussion we had and
realizing I know where this is going to go, it's going to be a 10, isn't it?
I'm giving it a 10.
All right.
Wow.
Way to score out of spite, Tommy.
Now, I am putting in parentheses next to this out of spite.
Yeah.
You'll have it.
I gotta balance it out. So whenever we get to the rankings, that it gives its fair share.
Can I go ahead and adjust my score and give it a 1?
Yes, you can.
Yes. Do you really want
to
give it a 1?
I need to adjust in the rankings as well, Tommy.
Yes, go for it.
Actually, can I give it a 0?
Yeah, no, give it a 0.
It's 1 to 10. Because if you let him
give
it a 0.
I'm
going to
take the high road and keep it at a 6.5.
Oh, hold on. Are you guys assuming that I've changed my vote because I'm angry at the argument? No.
No. Not at all.
Tommy changed his because he's angry at the argument, for sure.
No.
Dude, you were not going to score a 10 before, and you fucking know it.
No, I was going to score it a 9.7.
Exactly. So
he's not that far off of his initial score plan.
Yeah. But those 0.3 points are straight up spite points.
Sure.
What the? You just said they were.
Nope, you guys said it, and then I said
no,
sure.
No, you said it. You 100% said it.
No, I didn't.
I go
back and listen to it.
Yeah, we can go back and listen. But I like the fact that we'll have asterisks in our record book. You know, I want the one for Paul was on taking hormones for this one.
What?
Or taking what steroids? Paul was on steroids for this one. So take that into account.
All right.
Fair enough.
This week's review,
the most divisive,
was brought to you.
Ever.
Oh, dude! Before we started this, yeah. I was like, "This is the one I'm the least excited about discussing," because I knew it was going to go down this path. This week's episode was brought to you by General Motors, Harley Davidson, HTC, Under Armour, Bose headphones.
There was a lot of Under Armour in this film.
There was, yeah. No. No, it's just that they're sponsoring our show this week.
Under Armour
sponsoring our show.
Shout out to them.
Hershey.
We're all wearing Under Armour right now.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Under Armour. Apple. Not just Apple devices, but an entire Apple store sponsored this movie. And an Apple employee. Nike. Soft soap. Yeah, soft
soap.
That's
a very specific one. Hey, shout out to them. Thanks.
Dell Computers. And the Smithsonian Institute.
I got one for you.
Oh, please.
Bubble Yum Bubble Gum.
Yeah. I think that... It's the company who owns Bubble Yum.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. There were two different candy companies. Hershey was one, and then there was another one that I just didn't put on here. There were over 70 product placements in this movie.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. I didn't grab
them
all. Well,
they had to make up for after Captain America not being able to have any.
Right?
Yeah. Time to move on to the next segment that will only be featured in Phase 2. I'm a monster!
Monster.
So this one's a little bit more subtle.
Yeah, I don't...
I actually was watching for it, and I was like, well, you can kind of call Bucky Barnes, kind of?
That's it.
You never saw him really lose the arm, though, huh?
Nope. I mean, you kind of saw in the flashback scene, you get a little bit...
You see him grafting it on, so yeah, I guess that works.
But yeah, a lot more subtle than, you know, bluntly losing an arm.
And I was watching for it, and we got to the end of the movie, and I was like, hey, where was my de-limbing?
Yeah, I didn't see a single limb get lost. I just saw people murdered. That's some bullshit. Oh, man. When a Falcon jumps out of the building and he turns the helicopter sideways to scoop him up, I was thinking, man, how great would it have been if he did the helicopter blades shredded him like in Cap 1. And he's like, oh, fuck. That was absurd.
A lot of people died in this movie.
Yeah.
Cap crushes a lot of people's chests with a kick.
I was going to say, he kicked a lot of people. And I was thinking about it, and it must be because he's got that shield in his hand, right? He's really...
He doesn't want to look too one note.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I don't know. But he kicked a lot of people.
He kicked a lot.
By the way, that henchman guy, the henchman dickhead, the main guy, how the fuck, even after all the ass beatings he took, the one that was fighting Falcon at the end.
Oh, the one who, like, was in the building when it collapsed?
Yeah. Who still fucking lived?
Not only did he live, he's in Civil War.
He is in Civil War.
That shit makes fucking me sick. That guy is so annoying. He's like, why won't you die? And then a building collapses on him. He's like, turns out, this man had a bit of the super soldier in him.
I believe he says, you dropped a building on my head at some point in time.
Does he? He does, yes.
I mean, Hydra's plan was to purge, and he is in the purge.
Hey, man. It's all about that purge, you know what I'm saying?
You guys like the Purge movies?
I didn't.
Tommy, we watched one together, and it was all right.
But I feel like they've
gotten progressively worse.
I tell you what I do like is the Purge episode of Rick and Morty.
Yeah, that is pretty good.
Sure. That was a good one.
Let's move on to the secrets of the Marvel Universe.
Universe.
Number one, Captain America's catch-up list. He's got a little notebook where he has stuff that he wants to catch up on. Catch-up list includes I Love Lucy. And a lot of these have parentheses in them, and it'll say, like, television show. The moon landing. The Berlin Wall, in parentheses, it says up and down. Thought that was cool. Steve Jobs, in parentheses, it says Apple next to it. Disco.
That was, like, the worst part. Out of all the things on that list, he's like, I have to look up this Steve Jobs fella. It's like, how much did Apple pay for that? Fucking assholes.
iPhones changed the world. Disco.
Oh, so you're saying Rocky Balboa's... Steve Jobs should be on that list of essential viewing right up there with Rocky Balboa?
I don't think they're talking about... Get out. I don't think he's talking about the movie Steve Jobs. I think he's just saying...
No, I mean, but like, Steve Jobs is relevant, is as relevant as Rocky Balboa, the movie? Get out.
I mean, you're not wrong.
Rocky 2 specifically?
You're wrong about a lot of things. Get this out. One you are not wrong about.
Thank you. Thank you.
Disco. Thai food.
Yeah, I can. I'm down with that one though.
Me too.
Star Wars / Trek. I love that it says Star Wars / Trek in his notebook. Nirvana in parentheses band. Rocky with Rocky 2 in parentheses. Trouble Man soundtrack. That's the one that Sam asks him to download or check
and
out.
And what we're listening to at the end of the movie.
The scene where he's
that was by Marvin Taylor, right?
Yeah. so this one I had a hard time making out.
A long ways for that one.
This one I had a tough time making out. But I think it was it says TV and then hyphen, and I think it was Sherlock. It was what was at the very top of the page, based on the screenshot I saw.
Mm.
I don't know. Benedict Cumberbatch, Martin Freeman.
Yep,
they've never been in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. The Beatles. The World Cup final for 1966.
Wait, did he flip through multiple notepads? No.
There are more than one shot of notepads.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Sean Connery.
Hey, there we go.
Yep.
Dance Dance Revolution.
Which he would probably be really good at.
I bet he'd have a blast at it, you know?
Yeah. Jae Sung Park, who is a Korean or pretty sure
probably
he's
Chinese.
He might be Chinese
because they probably put that in there for the Chinese audience.
Well, it's right next to Old Boy. Not next to Old Boy. It's right above Old Boy.
I see.
But he's a fighter. He's like a kickboxer.
Well, I'm willing to guarantee there's a cut of it that they use for the Chinese audience that has like very specific Chinese references.
Maybe so.
They do that shit like basically to get permission.
The largest population
of Chinese
of
relevancy
a race
to screen
on Earth
that film. Yeah, but like the laws are like you have to have like it has to be relevant and supportive of like Chinese, like the government and everything, or like Chinese like entertainment in some way.
So that's why they did.
So that's why a lot of times like that's why they have to put that in there for it to screen over there.
That's why Iron Man got his surgery in China, is that they wanted to appeal to the censors in China.
Yeah. And supposedly the Chinese version of the movie also had more scenes with the Chinese doctor in it as well.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Iron Man 3, man. 10 out of 10. And the 2002 World Cup. Number two. Batroc the Leaper is the guy he fights on the tanker. And he's from the comics. And he like, he has a costume, but it's the same colors. It's like purple and gold. Number three, the freighter is named the The Lemurian Star. Lemurian Star, yeah. It's a nod to the comics. In the world of Marvel Comics, the Lemurians were a race of sea people with possible ties to the Deviants, a race created alongside the Deviants by the otherworldly being known as the Celestials. Number four, Pierce was one of Nick Fury's top covert agents. So Alexander Pierce was one of Nick's top covert agents in the comics, skilled in hand-to-hand combat, and was known to rival Black Widow and Hawkeye.
Very different, though, in this telling.
Yeah, he seemed more just like a pencil pusher type guy.
There are rumors.
Yeah. Not trained in combat.
Right. This might be confirmed somewhere, but I'm not sure, that Samuel L. Jackson's going to be in Captain Marvel.
Ooh.
So the rumors are that Captain Marvel's going to take place in the 90s.
Yeah.
And it's going to like have the scene with Samuel L. Jackson losing his eye and all this. These are just rumors, so I don't know about it.
I'm into that.
I'm really curious if, because based on a lot of the stories that Robert Redford was telling about him and Nick Fury.
Oh, maybe we'll get a Robert Redford.
Maybe we'll get like a de-aged Robert Redford in it.
You know, I was thinking if God forbid Sam Jack dies, they could say, probably save money by casting fucking Forrest Whitaker with his fucked up ass eye. You know what I mean? Just imagine that. They had to recast Forrest Whitaker as Nick Fury. I'd watch that. I'd at least give it a try. In fact, he should play young Samuel Jackson in the 90s. Him de-aged is Forrest Whitaker.
I just want to call out how good Ghost Dog is. I really enjoy the movie Ghost Dog, and I really recommend it. It's Forrest Whitaker at his best.
The soundtrack is fucking amazing. It was produced by RZA.
Yep. So if you're looking for a Forrest Whitaker kicking ass, Ghost Dog.
Fair also, enough. The 2002 Twilight Zone TV series.
Hey,
we talked about this for their Black Panther. Getting another Forrest Whitaker kick. Number five, Black Widow wears a necklace in the movie that has a charm of an arrow.
Oh, for Hawkeye.
Yeah, for her good pal. pal Hawkeye.
By the way, where is he in this film? Doesn't he work for S.H.I.E.L.D.?
You know what? He's not in this movie. I give it a 3 out of 10. He should have been in this movie.
I'm glad you're finally coming to your senses.
Yeah.
Go ahead and change his score.
Yeah,
you heard it from him.
Please do.
Oh, wait, are you not being serious? Are you being facetious?
What?
No,
not change the score?
I'm always serious.
Then change it to a 3.
I'm always being serious. Number 6. In Alexander Pierce's fridge, you see a bottle of Newman's Own Balsamic Vinaigrette.
Which is
Paul Newman's branded sauce.
Hello, Newman.
Paul Newman and Robert Redford are very good friends, and they starred in a movie together. Anybody know what that movie was? Paul Newman,
The
Bosom
Big
Buddies.
The Big Easy? No.
I mean, it's probably a lot of them, but the most famous movie they starred in
Born
Turner
to be
Free, and
Hooch.
Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Oh, that one, yeah.
That's close.
Number 7. Arnim Zola now has his comic book appearance as a face within a screen, which we talked about already. Number 8, the line, "Shall we play a game?" in front of the old computer that Natasha makes is a reference to
War Games.
Thanks, Pat.
With Matthew Broderick.
Yeah.
Which is going to be on at Alamo.
Yeah, whenever
we saw
Black Panther, they have those things where they play all the old movies that are coming back to the Alamo Draft House, and they had one for War Games, and I leaned over to Peb and I said, "I've never seen that." And he's like,
"You see, Tommy,
helped define my childhood.
You should have taken a page out of War Games' book.
War Games is why I tried to be a hacker.
Sometimes the only way to win is not to play."
Hey, but you know what else is showing at Alamo, just to call it out, is Iron Man. They're going to show Iron Man in the theater again.
10 out of 10. Number 9. Ed Brubaker, the writer of the Winter Soldier comic, is one of the technicians that is brainwashing Winter Soldier.
Mm.
So the guy who wrote the Winter Soldier is one of the guys who's brainwashing. Pretty interesting. Number 10. Joe Russo, one of the two directors, plays the doctor that comes to aid Nick Fury in the underground cave area.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, whenever we get the reveal that he's actually still alive. Number 11. Agent Sitwell drops a couple of names, including Tony Stark, Bruce Banner, and Stephen Strange, as we referenced. Number 12. Sitwell also mentions a valedictorian in Iowa City and a man located in Cairo, Egypt. One of Marvel's heroes is from Cairo, Egypt. Anybody know which one?
Storm?
Moon Knight.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, shit. That's a deep cut, man.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Well, Mr. Split Personality himself.
With the Russo brothers being involved, their biggest project prior was directing and producing episodes of Community. One of the leads from Community, Danny Putty, plays a S.H.I.E.L.D. tech that runs into Cap, Falcon, and Widow.
Yeah, I getting to see Abed just made me a very happy man. And especially, that was a really nicely done piece of subtle humor where he says, he comes in and he says, "We're coming in. There's nothing you can do about it." And Abed just basically goes, "Okay, dude, come on in. You're Captain America. You can go wherever you want."
Number 14, Fury's headstone has a passage from the Bible that's noted, Ezekiel 25:17. This passage is spoken to victims of Jules Winfield, the hired gun in Pulp Fiction.
Not a real passage either.
Yeah, but it's not. But it was the path of the righteous man.
It is.
And that's it for Secrets of the Marvel Universe. Time to move on to our friend Stanley. You guys remember the Stanley cameo in this?
I certainly do.
I absolutely do. I really enjoyed it.
DKP, can you tell me all about the Stanley cameo?
Well, at some point, Captain America's like, "I've got to save the world," as he's known to do. And he's wearing like a, you know, jeans and a hoodie, tennis shoes and shit. And then Falcon's like, "You're going to save the world dressed like that?" And he's like, "No. Before I save the world, I got to drive to the Smithsonian and steal my armor." And he does. And then somehow, Stan Lee happens to be there. As a security guard, and he realizes he's fucked, and he goes, "I'm so gonna get fired for this." That's about it.
Perfect.
It was good, though.
I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a good sort of a... the Stan Lee cameos talk about a part of the movie you didn't consider, the consequences of actions that were taken.
Notice post-credit scene when we're back at the Smithsonian, no sight of him. That poor man probably did get fired.
He probably did.
Oh, tragic.
Let's hope he's the night security guard.
That's true, and he's the night security guy.
I mean, he said that shit during the day, though. When he was going to go, because
he was the only one in there.
Yeah,
when he said it was just a slow day. Okay. I just hope that poor man kept his job.
Yeah, me too.
Or Captain America came back and, like, you know, lobbied for him to get his job back.
I hope so too. For all,
I just think it's really irresponsible to put that man out on the street. He's clearly very old.
All right. Now it's time for everybody's favorite segment, the post credits. Get out your fucking checkbook moment.
Hey, Taylor, get out your fucking checkbook. All right, that's what they were supposed to do. I don't want to wake your baby.
So there are two scenes. We have a mid-credit scene and a post-credit scene. In the mid-credit scene, we get our first look at Baron Wolfgang von Strucker and the twins, Wanda and Pietro Maximoff.
More importantly, we got to see the staff.
The scepter, yeah. It has Loki's the Mind Stone in it.
God, this mosquito hawk's back.
He's hungry for blood. I like that von Strucker says, "This isn't the age of spies. This is not even the age of heroes. This is the age of miracles, and there's nothing more horrifying than a miracle."
I expected him to almost say this is the
age of Ultron.
Yeah, he was so close.
Well, he's not going to say it, is he? I'm like, oh, okay.
This is the age of Ultron.
I thought it was a good post-credit scene, but the one thing that it did mostly was made me kind of disappointed that the Quicksilver we're getting isn't the one that I think of as like the really fun one.
The one from X-Men?
Yes. It's the one that, like...
I had that same sort of feeling, and it somehow... So one of my favorite characters in the comics was the witch. And
Scarlet Witch?
Yep. Yeah. And for some reason, this version of her is not as appealing to me. And
you're saying it's because she can't distort and warp reality?
Fabricate everything? But this just sort of paints her in the sort of this horror story-esque quality.
Yeah, it makes her look like a witch.
Yeah, I don't know.
And I'm not saying that that's a good thing. I'm saying that they really play up this idea that she's a witch.
Yeah, and it wasn't as... I didn't enjoy it as
like
much.
Like Paranormal Activity kind of witch.
Exactly, like not ghosts like, and yeah. The undead. And that wasn't really... She's more about like
a sorceress.
She was more about manipulating percentage chances, right? So she was more like rolling the dice when you'll always get good or bad. Or she's a lot like the black cat, you know, and she's sort of...
Or like Two-Face with his coin.
No. So I guess just this version of her is not as exciting to me as
we'll definitely
versions.
Talk about that a whole lot more in 2 weeks.
Totally.
And then we get a final post-credit scene, Bucky walking around the Smithsonian. looking around at the Captain America exhibit, stops and look at the exhibit of himself. Which
I was genuinely touched by this scene. I thought it was very sweet, and it really connected me to who Bucky was and the experience that he must be going through to encounter this person that he is but doesn't remember and trying to decide who he is. I found it to be very effective. I'm guessing you didn't have the same experience.
No, I mean, I didn't. I don't think it had the same like impact, but no, I thought it was okay.
What'd you think, Idify?
Idify, you there?
Hey, Tom, what'd you think while we're waiting?
It was cool. It's like, you know, you mentioned Bucky kind of being a flat character in this movie, and there is a piece of the real Bucky Barnes inside of the Winter Soldier, and we kind of see it coming out as the movie progresses, and then we get that scene that's like, okay, so maybe he is starting to kind of go back to who he was, even if just a little bit. Like, there is the real version of him is still in there, and that was confirmation that we still have a character, you know.
And in a way, what this scene told me was that he was having the same experience that Captain America was having, that they were both men out of time that had lost who they were and were never going to be able to have that experience again. And it made why the two men seem so drawn to each other make a lot more sense to me. And I also just wanted to call out, just because I didn't get a chance to, because I forgot until just this moment, I really like Captain America's interaction with the little kid who recognizes him at the Captain America show, where he just sort of puts his finger to his lips and goes, shh.
Yeah, I thought that was really rude. I don't like when people shush me in public.
I thought it was super sweet and very cool.
Idafi said he just sent me a message saying his audio is choppy.
Oh, bummer.
Okay. That fucking sucks.
We're gonna need his score upcoming, his predicted score coming soon.
Well, if he can still hear us, maybe he can just message it to me. TKP, do you know what I see in your future?
Possibilities?
Nailed it.
Man, it's the first time I know what was coming.
Next week's movie is Guardians of the fucking Galaxy. Oh,
thank God.
So here's, normally I would give a short summary based on how I don't remember anything about this movie. And the problem with this is that I can tell you word for word everything that happens in this movie.
I can almost recall every scene of this movie.
Exactly. So instead, I'm going to just give you Paul's quick summary. This movie is what if at that moment where your life is just so miserable and you say to yourself, I really wish aliens would just come and take me away from all of this shit. What if those aliens literally came down and did that? What would happen? That's what this movie is.
Well, let's be frank here. If I get to live the badass life he does, it can be going great for me, and I'll still be like, yeah, come take me. That seems fucking pretty rad. I get to hang out with fucking talking raccoons and big men with sensitive nipples, as we find out from, I think, Guardians 2. Yeah, I'm down with that.
Yeah, this, I mean, I guess we'll be talking about it, but it is such a fun movie. And that's kind of the best part about it is it's a fun movie.
I think it's currently my favorite Marvel movie.
So this movie for me is, I call it a Pirates of the Caribbean. It's a movie I went to expecting it to be shitty, and it turned into absolutely one of my favorite movies.
Pirates, that's just a fun series. Well, I've only watched the first like two.
But
I don't know about 5, 6, 7, 8, nine.
I've never seen one after the second one.
Just the first one is the point I'm making is that I went to it expecting to be awful and then had a great time. And I had that same experience for this movie.
Yeah, I'm really excited to watch this one. After it came out, it was like a struggle between this and Winter Soldier is like my favorite. And it still kind of is, but...
Well, here's the thing. Captain America, the first Avenger, I think is like the best one. It's not my favorite, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's not the one that I just think I had the most fun watching. I'll say, like, I think it's the best, like, written, directed, like, set piece, whatever. But, like... Doesn't mean you think it's the best one, but like favorite wise, I think my favorite one to go back and watch, just favorite one I enjoy myself most with, is Guardians.
Chris Pratt, man, what a G! Yeah, let's get our
Tom,
predictable.
What do you think you're going to score this?
9.8.
DKP.
I think I'm going to give it a 9.3.
I plan to give this, or I suspect that I will give this a 9.9. Just in fucking time.
Anybody want to take a guess as to what Idify's score is going to be?
What are you going
to
score, Guardians, buddy?
10.
All should, right.
Hey, you know, this is the first time where it's like, because every single fucking swing and dick here is 9 point something at the very least. So no ripping on you here.
Yep. We should have another segment where we predict Idify's score, like his prediction score.
That sounds awesome.
Anything else? Anything that anybody wants to talk about with Guardians or in closing for Winter Soldier?
One more thing about Guardians. If you put John C. Reilly in any Marvel movie, you automatically get like 8 or 9 points. The rest of it's just an automatic like on top, at least 8 points.
Yeah. I'm going to talk about it quite a bit next week whenever we actually talk about Guardians. But man, Guardians 2. Come on now.
I'm looking forward to all of these discussions.
Yes.
Same.
So yeah, that's it for this week's Preparation Avengers. Join us next week where we will be discussing Guardians of the Galaxy. Don't forget to like the video. It really helps us get the word out there. Subscribe to the channel. See when next week's episode is going to go live. You can also follow us on Twitter and Twitch to watch all of our gaming-related stuff. We've got a couple of other things in the works. Don't want to make any promises because most of that stuff never, ever comes to fruition. But I'm feeling confident about a couple of these ideas. Our panel, one last time. Danny.
Yes, sir.
Paul.
That's me.
Alex.
Hello?
Yo, yo. And I'm Thomas. And don't forget, Baskin Robbins always finds out.